I read somewhere that in your brain you have connections between some rooms in your brain. Yeah? And you know that all hearing people, they have a connection between the hearing part and the thinking part, the vocabulary part. There you have connections because you're used to everything you hear, you automatically make sense of it. And that deaf people, they have the visual room of the brain connects with the words part. So it's a different kind of line, kind of street between them. And that when I was starting with working with that group, and I am learning sign language as well now, that your brain have to make new lines, new connections between other parts of your brain. So your brain will work different, and also your communication will work different.
That's so cool.
Yeah, it's really cool.
Hi, this is the third chapter of Eventually I'd Have to Disappear, the podcast on the traces we leave behind as artists and how to work with them ethically, philosophically, artistically. You just heard Fonge Vrieling, student at Artes Theatre and Education and the artistic leader of the non-profit foundation TG Signum, which creates plays and performances for and with hearing and deaf people. We had our conversation in my living and working space in Zoetermeer, sitting on my bed surrounded by cups of coffee, books, pillows and other objects. Cats walked around in the garden, and behind that, children were running around in the schoolyard.
Deaf culture in the Netherlands, it's a culture. It's not only a handicap or only they can't hear and they use sign language instead of Dutch. No, they have a own culture and their own things they do and the people they are connected with. And how more I work together with them, how more I can see that and how more the cultures can mix. And it's just here. It's just in the Netherlands. It's not that they're from abroad. They're here.
Just this whole other culture among us, which we don't know anything about. It's really weird if you think about it. And just before we started the recorder, you said something that I have to think about now because you bring up the deaf culture, that you are also in some way working with broadening the archive or broadening the image that people have of certain groups or certain people. Can you maybe elaborate on that, how you do that, how you work with that?
I have a theater group now that specializes in that, working together with deaf and hearing people. Is a big step in the Netherlands because there are not many groups, no theater groups and some dance groups that work with deaf people together. And that a lot of deaf people have never been to a theater because if they are there, they can't hear it. And almost all Dutch plays, you can't follow if you can't hear the voices. I'm working with Ali Shafi. He is the only professional deaf actor in the Netherlands. And he said, I'm just going to some plays that are with text and I'm just sitting there and I enjoy the visual thing. I don't try to understand everything they're saying. I can't. But I like to see it. And yeah, he likes dance performances Because yeah. there's yeah. not many.
No spoken language.
No spoken language. Yeah. And the music, yeah. You see it in the rest of the body.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
So for the deaf people, it's broadening their life because they, I hope in the future, they can go to theater.
Mm.
And the plays we're making, they're always as well in sign language, so they can see. And that it broadens their art there they can go to.
Yeah.
And for the hearing people, I think that there are a lot of deaf people in the Netherlands. But almost no one can say, oh yeah, I know some deaf people.
Yeah.
But there
it's
are...
It's very separate.
Yeah, it's very separate. And I think that there are also some prejudice about deaf people that are not true. Because as hearing society, we always think that deaf people are disabled.
Mm.
And I think that's not true. They are just disabled because they are a minority in a hearing culture.
Mm.
If they're together without hearing people, they are not disabled.
Mm.
They are just talking another way.
Mm. Mm.
So I think that we live together in a very small country and we don't know a lot about each other. That's strange.
Yeah.
And I think we have to change the way we think about our, the place we live and things around us.
And do you think theater or art, in a more general sense, can do that?
I think it's a way that you can do it where everyone can express themselves.
Mm.
I think art is the way that it's the most easy to work together.
Mm.
Because in art you have to be interested in the other one.
Yeah.
If you make art together, you can't do it on your own because then you're not working together.
Yeah.
And I think in a normal life where everyone is busy, it's more difficult to do that.
Mm.
And that art can give a door, can open it up, and that hearing people can as well go to our place and can hear it as well, because everything will also be in Dutch language.
Mm-hmm.
But you can as well, at the same moment, see the sign language.
Yeah.
And then a lot of people say to us, oh, I could understand a lot of it.
Mm.
I didn't know, but I could.
Yeah, that's so cool. Yeah.
There's, from the past, I think an archive in how the cultures react to each other and work together. And I think it's good if that changes.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I've heard from a lot of different people, both hearing and deaf, that they find your performances or your plays very interesting. So it's artistically very interesting for, as well, people who are hearing and people who are deaf. And maybe you can talk a bit about that, what kind of artistic choices you make to make it appealing for these very separate, very different groups.
We want that our plays are artistic. We don't want that people come and see a play and you see, oh, it's socially important, but we make theater.
Yeah.
So for us, it's...
We're not social workers.
We're not social workers. And it's good if we do that at the same time. Yeah, of course. And it's good that hearing people can see a deaf person.
Yeah.
I think that's very important. But I think when we're making theater, what we try to do is combine the two cultures artistically.
Mm.
So I think that most of deaf people, the deaf people who are born deaf, they can, they're the people that use sign language the most.
Okay.
And they have, in their way of presenting, something with their whole body, what is artistic, very interesting.
Okay.
Because if we see a hearing actor play, it's mostly, not of all of them of course, mostly the head who's speaking and the body would join.
Follows. Yeah.
And with deaf people, it's other way around most of the time.
Okay.
Of course they think about what they are saying with their hands. But when they talk about something, when they explain something, they will always do it. If I tell a story about yesterday.
Yeah.
I will just say, I was doing this, she was doing that, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
And what they do, they say, okay, gesture, yesterday, and then they will reenact what they were doing.
Wow.
So it's more like storytelling, acting at the same time.
And that's also if they're just drinking coffee, telling something yeah, about yesterday.
Because
they do a reenactment of it.
Yeah, some people do it big and some less, but okay. Yeah, they do it because wow. In the sign language, the hands are important, the gestures, but as well as
the facial expressions,
and as well the lips.
Hmm.
So they will not talk with the lips, but what kind of movement they make with their lips is important as well.
Okay, wow.
So sometimes they... Yeah, it's very complex, and that all together.
Hmm.
I think that's one of the most important things. Yeah, the visual expression. And we always do as well in the plays that they're not without music. Because if hearing people see a play, we will always miss the music if it's not there.
Mm.
Because we're used to it.
Yeah.
And we also think, oh, it's quiet. It's very quiet. We will hear it immediately. And so most of the time we have some music, but it's important that we make another kind of translation that as well that the deaf people can feel the same ambience that we create with the music.
Yeah.
So that's the reason why we use a lot of projections. Yeah. Projections.
And we are talking now a lot about your engagement to different groups of humans.
Yeah.
And what I find very intriguing about you and your work is also your connection to the non-human entities. Let's call them. Because you have this very clear vision about how you want to work with different people and open up cultures, open up the archive, the way that there has been certain thoughts or knowledge production about them. And I think there's something similar with sometimes what you investigate or what you try to do with objects and with how people are in their surroundings, in their environment, with the objects that surround them.
Yeah.
Maybe you can elaborate a bit on your work that's more in that corner or in that space.
Mm-hmm. I think that we're all living in a world with a lot of things around us.
Mm-hmm.
Our environment is filled with objects. It's filled with other people as well, but with objects. And we always think that we use the things around us.
Mm.
That we move an object, that we have something because we can put their water in it.
Or
that we use everything.
Yeah, we have the agency.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think that's not really true because... Yeah, we buy things because we want to use them, but how they are formed and what they are, they will always tell us how to use them.
Mm.
And I think it's very individual to think that everything is because of us.
Yeah.
And it's not true, because there are a lot of people and it's as well because of them. Mm. But there are as well rabbits in the garden or somewhere and it's also because of them.
Yeah.
So... Why wouldn't it be as well because of the objects we create?
Mm.
I think the objects we create are some kind of archive of the human culture, of the of human, because we thought, oh, it's handy, or oh, I think this is beautiful, so I have this, I make this.
Yeah.
And I think it's interesting that the way we use things around us, or interact with them, it's not always about using. About, oh yeah, I need this, so I bought it because, yeah, now I can sleep because I have a bed.
Yeah.
But we have a bed because we sleep always in it.
Yeah.
We just thought about it once ourselves and now everyone uses it.
Yeah, yeah.
So the fact that we have a bed like this is because... our culture evolved that way.
Mm.
And I think that in theater it's interesting that we as well see that other way around.
Okay.
and to see if we can reenact with the subjects and objects around us in a different way than we used to. Because then they become interesting for us.
Mm.
Because they surprise us.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think if we have, let's say a towel, you can use it to dry yourself, yeah. But if you try to make it move like it's flying, or like it's talking, or like it's dancing around the room, mm-hmm. then it becomes very interesting.
Yeah.
Because every towel will do, will do different.
Mm.
You can't do the same thing with two different objects.
Mm. Yeah.
And I think in theater, that's interesting, because then you will see, and also the public will see, how the things around us change us, yeah, as well.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, our environment has a lot of influence on us.
Mm. I like what you said a while back, that it's kind of individualist and to think that we are the ones with agency. And now if you think about climate and weather, and it becomes more broad. That's not just the human in the middle, like very, very vertical. We are standing here and from there we are moving.
Mm-hmm. But then
we
are, the sun, yeah.
Yeah, we are inside some sort of space with all these different kind of influences that go through us, and we go maybe through all the other influences. Yeah. And it's more of a network than one single entity standing upright.
Yeah, that's a good explanation. Yeah. Yeah, and I think there it is where it becomes interesting.
Mm.
Yeah, of course, you are important to yourself, because you are... if you're not there, you don't have a mind. You don't have anything. So you are important, but... yeah. We will die as well. And the things around us, maybe they will exist for, I don't know, more than 1,000 years.
Yeah.
It could be.
Yeah.
So that's the reason why people do things in a box and shoot it to the moon or whatever. And then I have a question for you, because we talked about how I see our surroundings with all the objects as interesting to use.
And she asked me about the objects in my project Het Huis, or The House, which I did with Vera van Oostveen and Elisa Klabbers. Last year we went to live together in a house in a residential area in Apeldoorn. We created art together, we did exercises centered around bodily knowledge. We made the house we were living in our artwork. We also went outside of the house to lectures, talks and exhibitions, and into the streets, to connect with people there and with the neighbors, who we also brought back into the house. So we said to them, bring your food, bring your drinks, let's discuss together what we are doing here, and maybe create something together with the people who come from the surroundings of the house. At the end of the process, we invited the neighbors and other people into the house for 2 final evenings, in which we divided them into groups and gave them a script that would lead them through the house. Funge asked me why there were certain objects in this house and how we worked with them. I told her there were 3 kind of categories of objects in the house. The first one is the ones we created during our process. We gave them a place in the house, so our living space would become an artwork, and our process would be displayed on the house itself. The second category were objects we used on a daily basis, pots and pans, our beds, our toiletries, etc., which were also a part of the process, a document of it, and therefore a part of the artwork. And especially for the last evenings with the scripts, we installed certain objects to trigger a certain conversation or exercise mentions in the scripts. I give an example in the conversation with Funge.
We had worms, little worms, and there was this exercise and kind of discussion in one of the scripts whether you could bake them in the kitchen or not. And these worms were alive. And during the process, the 3 of us had a lot of discussions together, but also with other people, about how we are living now with the animals around us, and that we relate to them also in a relationship of usership. So we are not living with animals, we are using them for meat, for other kinds of food or drinks, but also to work for us, or they are
art purposes
or whatever mm-hmm. we are. And even if they are our pets, it's also not a very equal relationship.
Mm-hmm.
So we were thinking about that a lot and discussing it a lot also with other people we met during the period. And so we wanted to give the people who came to the house on the last nights also kind of an opening to discuss a similar
yeah.
subject. So in that way, we used this object to trigger a similar discussion as the one that we had. And that was something that we tried to do a lot during the evenings, to get the visitors to do some sort of reenactment, or maybe to get a little bit of the experience that we had had over the period of 6 weeks.
Yeah. So it's some kind of reenactment of the archive you made yourself.
So it was just opening up the archive and showing it to people.
Yeah, the whole house.
Yeah, exactly, in the form of the house. Yeah. And at the same time, we didn't just want to present what we did, but also keep it alive. So we wanted people to, like you say, reenact certain things or go back to certain discussions that we had. So it was kind of this combination of showing or presenting the archive and keeping it alive by reenacting aspects of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an important part, because if you just show something or present it, it also dies in my eyes, because then it's rounded up, it's closed, and it becomes this very stable, very vast
presentation.
Yeah. And also the memory becomes very, how do you say it? It's closed. But if you reenact parts of it, you keep it alive and you make sure that it can develop further and that it can become something else, something that we didn't think or that we didn't thought about when we were creating it. And I think it's important that it can go to different places and that it can always keep being influenced by other perspectives, other people,
mm-hmm.
other objects, other animals, whatever.
Is then one of the things that keep that archive alive just that you're there?
It can be, but I would like it to spread further than just mm-hmm. the three of us. And so Jesse van der Wel,
mm-hmm.
this friend of mine, he had this idea, but I'm not sure if it's still happening because he had a lot of ideas. But he had the idea, he wasn't in the house, so not during the process, but also not in the evening presentations. So he didn't get any of the things that mm-hmm. were happening. But I did give him a script. Mm-hmm. So he had no context or whatsoever, he just had a script. And he was thinking about making a music theater performance based on the script.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also something I find very interesting, because I am not involved in that. And also Vera and Elisa, who were doing it with me, have no say in that or are mm-hmm. not in any way connected to what he's doing. And also for Jesse, he wasn't present, he has no idea.
The only connection is the script.
The only connection is this object or this yeah. text that is then transformed from something that guides you through the house to a musical score.
Yeah.
And I also think that that's something that keeps the archive alive, or even breaks it open again, because there comes a new interpretation,
yeah.
but that doesn't have anything to do with me or with the other people that were in the first creating phase, but then it can go further, it can develop, and it can take very unexpected forms that are cut loose from the original source. And I find it interesting if it's not about me keeping it alive, but kind of spreading
to other disciplines. To the little stones, the
yeah.
green stones you gave everyone that was present at a presentation about this
yeah.
Performance, and you said to them, put that little stone somewhere on your body
yeah.
and carry it with you, and on some place where you like it, you can leave it.
Yeah, leave it behind.
Leave it behind. And then maybe some other person will find it and will think, whoa, a little green stone, or whatever.
Yeah.
You don't know. maybe it will be thrown in a bin. You don't know.
Yeah.
So is that as well a kind of trying to give the performance some kind of room, some kind of space to carry itself further?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And you don't know if something will happen with it.
Yeah. And I don't have to know. I don't need to have a hard proof that it goes beyond what I thought up in the first place. I just like the idea that those stones are out in the world somewhere. Maybe in a public space, maybe fallen out of someone's clothes and lying under a bed or whatever. But I really like the intention of just giving something and saying, hey, take this with you, and who knows what will happen.
Yeah,
it's out of my control.
It's as well a kind of paradox with the word archive, because an archive is I think about an archive, it's some kind of place where things are gathered that have the they have something in common.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have to be a place. It can also be something in the cloud, or it can be on different things. But it's always a collection.
Yeah,
it's always something gathered together because they're all books, or because they have something in common. And if you take, for example, the house and everything that's growing onto it, out of it, like the scripts, it's all some kind of outing from death.
Yeah.
Then with the little stones, it's out of the archive, because you don't know. And I think that you are now together with Elisa and Vera, the gatherers.
Yeah.
So maybe it's planting a little seed out of the archive that will connect it, and the other way. On the other side, you don't know. So, is it still part of the archive? Or is it triggering some new kind of archive?
Yeah.
What's the...
Nice, yeah. Well, what I think is the danger of the archive is exactly this thing that you are mentioning now. That it is a collection of things that are kind of similar. And I think what the archive does, because of how it is organized, is that it communicates this one story, this one narrative, one kind of perspective, even if it includes different perspectives of different people, because it is gathered in one place and because certain people give labels to it or whatever, it becomes this unity and it communicates one story. Yeah. So what I try to do is break that open and make sure that there's never one completely closed story, but that it's also at any time open for someone who doesn't agree, or someone who has a different background, or someone who has had a certain experience which makes this person look differently upon it. So I really want to make sure that it never becomes this kind of sealed entity that we just accept as being the truth, but that it's always open for things we didn't know yet.
So the little stones, they only say, I am that stone, but there is no text of it, so it's just what it is.
Yeah.
And its past was this archive, so it will take it in other way with it.
Yeah.
Where the script, for example, it includes more context because of the text, what's inside of it. Another kind of context than the little stones will give the finder.
And I think context is not necessarily a bad thing, but I think it often provides us with an account of how something was. And that's often one perspective that doesn't leave room
for the
people
thing.
Who had a very different experience of that time. So that's why I want to be careful with accepting that as a truth, and I want to open up this archive for other truths and other ways of seeing things.
Yeah. But I think I'm triggered by this idea of that little stone, because I think I can understand why you said it's good that it's out there and that I don't know what's going on with it now, but it would be interesting in some way around, you don't know how, it will come back.
Yes, of course. Yes.
Yeah.
But then there's still like a very big blank on how it came back.
Yeah.
So I like not knowing, and I want to make sure there's enough space for blank spaces and not knowing in the archive and in a way we remember things, so because that leaves room for other ideas and other perspectives. If you know everything, it's shut.
Yeah.
It's done.
I think that's a good last sentence.
I think so too. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That was the end of our conversation. Being both artists and teachers, Vonge and I have the chance to work with different and diverse groups. In this conversation, we exchanged our ideas on working together with people, animals and objects, and on how to work against certain images or power structures in the archive, and thereby in our society and everyday life. More and more, I find myself looking for a movement that encloses all of this, some sort of intersectional feminism, that also works for the environment, that makes an effort for human rights without seeing the human as center of the universe. If you have any ideas, let me know. Maybe our next guest can also help. Thank you for listening to another chapter of Eventually I'd Have to Disappear. Please tune in next time. Bye!